the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel, and his Holy One to him oppressed by tyrants. Thus saith the Lord, I am he that comforteth. Be not afraid, be not afraid, for I am thy God. Be not afraid, be not afraid, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. The Lord will strengthen thee.
Good morning, and welcome to worship with the Presbyterian Church of Wyoming. I am Becky Bosarge, Director of Pastoral Care. We are physically separated, but we are spiritually united. This is holy ground. Now, today is a communion Sunday, so if you like, gather your elements, some kind of bread or cracker, some kind of juice, so that you can be ready to take communion with us. And now open your heart and allow yourself to be welcomed and gathered in God's love.
Good morning. I am Mo Miller, and I am here to lead the call to worship. Please join your spirit with mine as we are called to worship. Psalm 61 reads, God, listen to my cry. Pay attention to my prayer. When my heart is weak, I cry out to you from the very ends of the earth. Let me lead me to the rock that is higher than I am. What is your cry today? How is your heart? Whoever you are and however you come, imagine that God has taken you by the hand and is leading you to a higher place, a place where you can breathe, a place from which you might gain a new perspective on God, on God's word, and on yourself. Take a deep breath and let us worship God.
Make me broken so I can be healed. 'Cause I'm too calloused, now I can feel. I want to run to you with a heart wide open. Make me broken. Make me empty so I can be filled. 'Cause I'm still holding on to my will. And I'm completed when you are with me. Make me empty till you are. lonely, so I can be yours. 'Cause I want no one more than you, Lord. 'Cause in the darkness, I know you will hold me. Make me lonely.
Our journey towards spiritual freedom is recognizing those things that hinder us. So we recognize those by being honest and confessing our need for God's help. Join me in praying our common confession. Liberating God, this weekend our nation celebrates the ideal of freedom. And yet we, your children, Jesus followers, spirit people, admit that we are not as free as you would have us be. I am free to enjoy a meal without thinking about those who are hungry. I am free to enjoy nature without worrying that someone will feel threatened by my presence. Is this what you mean by freedom? In my quiet moments, I wonder, how is it with my soul? God, you want more for your world than that. You want more for me than that. What sort of freedom are you birthing in your world, in me? How can I be open to the ongoing work of your Spirit to bring each of us and all creation to your kind of freedom? Second Corinthians says, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Friends, our lives as spirit people are incomplete, but they are not uncertain. Be assured that you are being transformed by the power of God's Spirit, your life shaped in and for love. Being assured of that and confident in that, may the peace of Christ dwell in our hearts and set us free to love and serve God.
Hi, this is Adam Hayden, the Youth Program Director here at PCW. I'd like to take a moment and invite all the kids come around the screen, so come on over. Now, good morning, hello kids. You might have heard the word, you might hear the word freedom tossed around a lot. It's a word that we hear in this country a lot. It's a word that we actually talk about in church. And when we talk about freedom in church, it's kind of a different kind of freedom. You know, freedom is all about choices, and we have the freedom to choose, and we can decide to do whatever we want to do when we're free. But the type of freedom we talk about with Jesus is the freedom to follow him, the freedom to do what's right. We don't have the freedom to punch our brothers and sisters in the face. That's not the type of freedom we're talking about. We don't have the freedom to steal our friends' toys or our siblings' toys, or we don't have the freedom to yell at our parents and say mean things to them. That's not the type of freedom I'm talking about. But we have the freedom to use our choices to do what's right, to do good to others, to help those that maybe don't have as much freedom as you and I might have. And so this week, the challenge for all of us is to think about how we can use our choices to help other people. All right? Can you do that this week? I'll try to do it with you too, okay? All right, now if you want to say a prayer with me, you can close your eyes, you can put your hands together if that helps you pray, and you can repeat after me, all right? Dear God, thank you for giving us choices. Please help us use choices to honor you. Amen.
This is the prayer for illumination. Guide us, O God, by your word and spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover your peace through Jesus Christ. Amen. We will hear our reading, Galatians 5:13-18 and 25-26 from the Message paraphrase. It is absolutely clear that God has called you to a free life. Just make sure that you don't use this freedom as an excuse to do whatever you want to do and destroy your freedom. Rather, use your freedom to serve one another in love. That's how freedom grows. For everything we know about God's word is summed up in a single sentence. Love others as you love yourself. That's an act of true freedom. If you bite and ravage each other, watch out. In no time at all, you will be annihilating each other, and where will your precious freedom be then? My counsel is this: live freely, animated and motivated by God's Spirit. Then you won't feel the compulsions of selfishness. For there is a root of sinful self-interest in us that is at odds with a free spirit, just as the free spirit is incompatible with selfishness. Those two ways of life are antithetical, so that you cannot live at times one way and at times another way, according to how you feel on any given day. Why don't you choose to be led by the Spirit and so escape the erratic compulsions of a law-dominated existence? Since this is the kind of life we have chosen, the life of the Spirit, let us make sure that we do not hold it as an idea in our heads or a sentiment in our hearts, but work out its implications in every detail of our lives. That means we will not compare ourselves with each other as if one of us were better and another worse. We have far more interesting things to do with our lives. Each of us is an original. The Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
This weekend, our country celebrates independence, the ideal of liberty, freedom. Freedom is such a beautiful word, and I think it's a human longing. We all want to be free, to have what we need to flourish, to care for our families, to enjoy our lives, to offer our gifts to the world, to find purpose, to be what we were created to be. We know, though, that our national ethic of freedom has never been fully realized. We have a complicated and sometimes ugly history that has created systems, the effects of which continue to this day. Some of us have always been, and still are, more free than others. And as we struggle with that concept of freedom, it comes up a lot in our national dialogue. It's coming up a lot now in our conversations about racial injustice, as well it should, and in so many other potentially life-giving ways as people fight for that kind of freedom that we all long for. And it's coming up in a lot of other ways that may be worth thinking about, examining. Is wearing or not wearing a mask a question of freedom? Is reopening or not reopening an issue of freedom? Or what about religious freedom in our national conversation? Is baking a cake for a gay couple a question of freedom, or providing medical care for a trans person an issue of freedom? I want to suggest to you that the freedom in Christ that Paul is talking about in the letter to Galatians that we heard today, spiritual freedom, the biblical idea of freedom, often gets filtered through the lens of our national conversation about freedom, even religious freedom, as if they're the same thing. So this morning, I want us to spend some time separating those two. I want to see what Paul has to say about the freedom we have as Jesus followers, led by the Spirit, separate from our national ethic of freedom. Paul might help us approach our national concept of freedom, even religious freedom, a little bit differently. Paul's letter to the churches in Galatia is a very brief, passionate, often angry letter. And it is well known for the theme of freedom. So here's the backstory. Paul preached the gospel to Gentiles in Galatia. They embraced it, and churches were formed. At some later point, other people came to Galatia, preaching a different gospel, as Paul would say. This different gospel advised the Gentile Christians that they also need to observe the law. For example, celebrating certain feasts, dietary restrictions, and even circumcision. Now, some of what Paul writes in this letter can be problematic, and we Christians need to be very careful as we interpret it. Paul is not disparaging the law, and he is not arguing with Jews. Paul never wrote discouraging Jews from following the Torah. He's arguing here about a definition of salvation for Christians, insisting that they do not need to engage in Jewish practices to be justified. That's a very Pauline word. So he spends the first part of the letter defending the gospel he preached, defending his qualifications, defending the position that trust in Christ is all that is needed. And finally, he sums up his argument in chapter 5, which begins, "For freedom, Christ has set us free." Now, what sort of freedom is Paul talking about? What are these Christians free from, and what are they free for? Well, according to Paul, they are free from a need to earn God's love or perform for God, and free to depend on God's grace in Christ for their forgiveness, their love, their joy. They are free from living based on their fears and unhealthy behaviors that harm themselves and one another, and free for a full, abundant life of healthy relationships. They are freed from this present evil age, Paul says. The wisdom of this world and its dominant power systems, and free to embrace the wisdom of the Spirit. They are freed from dividing the world into conflicting groups. As Paul says, there is no longer Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female. They are freed to see all people as those whom God loves. Now, as much as we long for freedom, this complete kind of freedom can be scary. And so it seems all too natural that these Galatians would be vulnerable to trying to do more in order to calm their fears and anxieties about being on the right track. This is a really common detour on the road to spiritual freedom. Surely, God will love me more if I go to church 3 out of 4 Sundays a month. Surely God likes people who read their Bible every day more than people who don't. Surely I have to give more of my time and energy to those in need in order for God to approve of me. No. Paul says it doesn't work that way. We don't do first, then we are loved and freed. Instead, God loves us, frees us in Christ, then we are free to love and serve freely. Now, this freedom in Christ, the freedom for which we have been set free, the freedom to love and be loved, has some boundaries. As Paul says, do not use your freedom for self-indulgence, but through love, become slaves to one another. Slaves to one another. That doesn't exactly sound like the usual ways we think about freedom. Martin Luther wrote about this paradox of the freedom we find in Christ by the Spirit. He said, by faith, we are completely free in Christ, subject to none. But by love, we are bound to all, servant to all. That's the tension the Galatians lived in, and the tension we live in, with the continual struggle to figure out how to keep the freedom of me from overriding the freedom of us. Now, growing in spiritual freedom, living in and by the Spirit, is not just about the things that we do. It's also an ongoing inner journey that results in outer expressions, as Paul would say, the fruit of the Spirit. So I want to leave you with one way to nurture that inner journey toward spiritual freedom for yourself. And I invite you to try this on a regular basis. Give it time to work on you. So this is a form of prayer, so I invite you to find a quiet, comfortable place. Ask God to help you see what you need to see. And then look back over the previous day. And remember a moment in which you were unfree. A difficult moment, a moment when fear or anxiety got the better of you and you reacted poorly. A moment you failed to act and wish that you had. A moment you didn't feel spiritually free. And really remember that moment and how it felt. Maybe name some of the feelings that you had. Then remember that moment again, and this time, imagine God is watching it with you. Try and see it through God's eyes. Then look back again and remember a moment in which you felt free, a moment when you felt alive, truly yourself, at peace, engaged, loving, spiritually free. Remember that moment and name some of the feelings that you had in that moment. Then again, look at the moment with God. Try and see it through God's eyes. See it through the eyes of a God who wants you to be more and more free. Spend some time celebrating that moment with God. And then look forward to tomorrow. How could you live more freely? What grace do you need? Ask God for help or make a commitment. And then end by repeating this breath prayer. And you may want to carry this breath prayer with you throughout your week. On the inhale, you say, for freedom. And on the exhale, Christ has set me free. For freedom, Christ has set me free. For freedom, Christ has set me free.
We're invited to the table of the Lord. We're invited to the table of the Lord. He says, come just as you are to his table. the table of the Lord. We're invited to the table of the Lord. He says, come just as you are to his table. The table of the Lord. There is peace at the table of the Lord. And I won't worry anymore at his table. There is healing at the table of the Lord. There is healing table of the Lord, and I won't suffer anymore at his table. Come all who weary, come and find, his yoke is easy, his burden.
For freedom, Christ has set us free. Free to accept God's love and to love God in return. Free to love and serve God's children. Free to love and care for God's creation. Free to accept and love ourselves. At this table, Christ welcomes and feeds us. God loves us. At this table, the Spirit enlivens us. The table is set. You are free to come. Let us pray. Creating, liberating God, you created a beautiful world and you created human beings to live in it and tend it. You created us for flourishing and freedom. for peace and justice, for meaning and wholeness. When we find ourselves divided, limiting our own freedom or the freedom of others, you call us back to your way of loving kindness. Jesus showed us what it means to be truly human, freely loving you and freely serving the whole world. Emptied out, servant to all, he noticed, heard, touched, and spent time with those whom society deemed the least of these. He removed barriers to freedom. The power systems of his day killed him, but death could not defeat the love and freedom you offer through and in him. Following his way, we pray for those who are not free to be what you created them to be. We pray for those whose freedom is limited by illness, poverty, lack of health care, job loss. We pray for those whose freedom is hindered by racism. We pray for the lonely, the ones whose family ties are broken or strained. We pray for the isolated. We pray for the whole world grieving the staggering losses of life and the depressing loss of our usual ways of working, parenting, graduating, starting college, forming relationships. We pray for the freedom that comes with your truth. Jesus invited us to ever-growing freedom, and to encourage us on that journey, he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Living in your spirit, led by your spirit, we come freely and confidently to this table. We ask that you pour out your spirit on this bread and this cup. Fill us and free us. We pray that we will be brave and faithful, bearing the fruit of your spirit until all people are free, all divisions are healed, and all creation flourishes and glorifies you. Through Christ, by your spirit, we pray. Amen. On the night of his arrest, Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new relationship with God. Drink it and remember me." This is the bread of life and the cup of salvation given for you. Please pray with me. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Friends, may you be blessed this week, knowing that God created you for freedom, that in Christ you have been set free, and that by the Spirit you are free to realize the fruit of that freedom, which is love for God, for others, and for yourself. Go in peace to love and serve God.